Dear friends, welcome to the fifth week of our Lenten retreat, Saving Grace. And we hear this week from the first reading of the Sunday liturgy for the fifth Sunday from the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, who made a way through the sea, a path in the great waters, who put chariots and horse in the field, and a powerful army, which lay there never to rise again. Snuffed out, put out like a wick. No need to recall the past. No need to think about what was done before. See, I am doing a new deed. Even now it comes to light. Can you not see it? Yes, I am making a road in the wilderness, paths in the wild. The wild beasts will honour me, jackals and ostriches, because I am putting water in the wilderness, rivers in the wild, to give my chosen people drink. The people I have formed for myself will sing my praises. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in the mother of your divine Son, the Lord Jesus, you have revealed to us the example of a disciple who is faithful to your words of life. Open our hearts, we pray, to receive your saving word, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, it may speak to us this Lent and throughout our lives, and direct us to bring forth a rich harvest of holiness as we go forth into the world to share that same love which you have lavished upon us with our brothers and sisters. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
There is a way in the wilderness. That's the message of this Sunday's Old Testament scripture. It's a trackless waste, yet God makes a way here. A desert land, barren and without water. Yet God makes rivers and springs to come forth. A message of hope for the difficult experiences of our life. As the name suggests, the wilderness is wild and untamed. All too easy to get lost. No paths, no direction signs, not somewhere you might choose to be. And yet the scriptures tell us a place of renewal, where God does new things. Do not remember the former things, or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. So where does the wilderness lie? Not many of us will go to a physical desert, at least not all that often. But what will touch us are those experiences that take us out of our familiar ground, where we feel lost and insecure. The wilderness between ending and beginning. It might be the death of someone we love. How does life go on? The ending of a role that's defined our sense of who we are, the shape of our day, and what happens next. The wilderness between loss of meaning and recovery of meaning. And whilst that recovery might give us fresh direction for our lives, it can be a long and lonely journey. The wilderness between awareness of a deep longing. We don't always know what it is we long for, only that we have this sense, deep sense, that something is missing. And finding that we yearn for. The wilderness between questioning and the start of understanding. The questioning of who we are or what we live for or who God is even. Questions are unsettling, but when they rise in our mind and they don't go away, perhaps they carry meaning, a sense of path for the way ahead, if only we stay with them. In all these ways, the wilderness is a place of testing, not how strong we are, but what's real, what's true, what's important. That's what happens when we go into unfamiliar ground. Previous assumptions fall by the wayside. In this new place, we feel the challenge of really understanding and living out who we are, the challenge of discerning what's important, what we will give our energy to, the challenge of not being driven, yet finding a path of freedom, of choice, that is also a way of life. The wilderness is a place of renewal. Unlikely, it seems. As unlikely as spring, we marvel at it each year, the ground so cold and dead and leaf litter, and yet in a few short weeks, life springs through. The spirit creating life from the dead ground. At this time of Lent, we look forward to the Passion of Jesus. It's an ugly story in many ways, a story of pain and loss, anguish, evil, betrayal, fear. Yet it's also our story of hope, because here Jesus chooses to enter into the suffering, struggles, confusions, and losses of hurting humankind. The sufferings of Jesus are backlit by resurrection, a resurrection that goes on flowing into our lives. COVID was a wilderness experience, one that we're all too ready now to put behind us. It's been a long struggle. We want to let it go like so many masks we see fall into the ground. Yet, were there important things we saw in that time of wilderness? I remember saying, we can't go back to the normal. We have to do things differently. So many of us were thinking along those lines. We were thinking about our personal lives, recognizing how driven we were, how we were giving our attention and our time and our energy to things that weren't so significant. The importance of people, looking after those close to us. And this was happening on a collective level too. It was time we began to see to rethink the way we live, how we treat creation. We can no longer abuse it. It's time to honour and reverence the creation we are part of. We saw the danger of us and them language, the destructiveness of it, a destructiveness we see now in Ukraine. What were the things you saw in the time of wilderness that you want to hold on to, let God into? Pope Francis urges us to think about the way we live. The pain, uncertainty and fear, and the realization of our own limitations brought on by the pandemic have only made it all the more urgent that we rethink our styles of life, our relationships, the organization of our societies, and above all, the meaning of our existence. So we can't go back to that old normal. But what will this new life look like? We need to listen to God, who makes a way from the wilderness and allows rivers to spring forth from the dry land. There's something this week, then, about recognizing God with us in the wilderness places of our experience. No separation between hurting humankind and God. Is there something also important about choosing the wilderness? Choosing to listen, to allow questions, to think more deeply about the life we're living. In this week's witness, we hear from Father Doug as he goes on a pilgrimage walk. And the walk asks those deep questions, and in time, and not without struggle, leads him to a fresh and life-giving understanding of who he is in God. Here is our prayer for the week. Father of compassion, you seek us in the wilderness places of our experience. Turn our hearts to you. Jesus, brother and friend, you travel with us through uncertainty and struggle. Lead us on the way of life. Holy Spirit, like a river, you flow through all creation. Refresh and renew our spirit. Amen.
Hello, I'm Father Doug, a priest, parish priest of this diocese. A few years ago, as I turned 60, I decided to make a pilgrimage and walk the 500 miles of the famous Camino from Saint-Pierre-de-Port in France, over the Pyrenees, and across Spain to the shrine of Santiago de Compostela. I determined to take my time over 30 days and gain from it all that the great metaphor of a tough, challenging physical journey could offer. At that deep personal level, my expectations were high. I'd seen films, read books, and listened to countless stories of self-discovery. I was virtually writing the script before I left, anticipating plenty of deep encounters with fellow pilgrims along the way. But what I actually encountered was a wilderness around me and a wilderness within. There were some encounters, all right, but not so many. There were days without any real conversation at all. And when I did walk with someone for a while, I often felt that I had nothing worth saying, or I'd merely swapped cliches about the Camino with my fellow pilgrims. I was empty. So was this the real metaphor? Was my life and my ministry equally a void? You know, there wasn't much in my rucksack, but there wasn't much in me either. I felt exposed, vulnerable, deeply lonely. The wilderness is not a romantic place, it's a harsh place. Despite all the planning that went into the adventure, I concluded that I'd made a mistake, a big one, or at least I was in a time of uncertainty. This wasn't the script I planned. I felt stupid, crushed, a waste of space. After several weeks, I finally gave up on the script of my pilgrimage. But instead, I tentatively offered God the chance to share his script. I stopped thinking about the pilgrimage as being for my sake and offered it up to him for his sake. And that's when I recognized that there actually was an encounter going on between him and me, and that it was framed as my little lowercase I am stood against his gigantic uppercase I am. Slowly, I came to see that my little I am had some significance. But I only stood next to his I am. It had no significance or meaning on its own. I knew that my place was at the foot of his I am. And in that truth, I could see myself and himself in proper perspective. And then I was able to feel his love, a love that changed everything. I drew the curtains and what do you know? The light shone in. And in that place, I could then see the love that others had for me as well. And I began to reconstruct my world around who was important to me, whom I loved and who loved me. I was in a new place with God. And now the Camino made sense. There was a renewal of my relationship with God and a subsequent renewal of my outlook on the world, or at least my part of it, and particularly on the people who populate it. I had a fresh understanding of what was important. The Camino was no mistake after all. And I fixed on resolutions about what I would and would not do post-Camino. It was quite a journey, but a very different one to the one I planned. God bless. Thanks for listening.